everybody, and welcome to another exciting, hair-raising, fun-filled episode of Radiorama, where I show you, as the name implies, how I work on radios. And today, we have a 1942 General Electric Model X-156. I've never seen this model before, and I suspect it's actually an export model. Probably for South America. We have Spanish in the back. And we have multiple settings for the transformer. This set can operate on 103, 117, 185, 215, 250 volts. It can operate also on 25 or 50 and 60 cycles, respectively. So probably, I'm not sure if this was sold in the U.S. or if it was strictly sold to South America, or maybe it could have actually been sold in Europe too. Those are all European voltages. Now, I'm not sure how far I'm going to be able to get into it, because this power transformer doesn't look very happy. Now, it could be because it doesn't have a bell housing, and so the tar over the years being used gradually melted. That's not unusual, but since it doesn't have a bell housing, that's not being contained. It also has a sheet of asbestos underneath the chassis, which isn't the end of the world. You just got to be careful with it. You don't really want to stir it up or disturb it. If you do not personally feel comfortable working around asbestos, I'd advise you just leave it alone. Maybe go on to another project. There is no 100% safe minimal exposure to it. From what I understand, you're more than likely to experience health hazards if you are around it a lot, like as in professionally, and you're a smoker. That said, like I said, there's no 100% safe guaranteed exposure minimum. So I try to limit my exposure by not disturbing it that much and also wearing a respirator when I remove it. They didn't put asbestos underneath a lot of radios. I think the idea was if something sparks underneath, then the asbestos will keep the wooden bottom from catching on fire. That said, I'd find it extremely difficult to believe that would actually ever happen. I've never seen proof of a radio having done that. Doesn't say it can't happen, but that's interesting to me. It's not a particularly high tube count radio. In fact, I think it's just 5 tubes. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Yep, it's just a 5 tube set. Now, it does have shortwave, so it probably has some additional enhancements underneath that will make it a little more sensitive. It looks like we have a permanent magnet speaker. It's kind of unusual for 1942, because at that point, most speakers were still using field coils versus a permanent magnet. So, I think what I'm going to do, and also I can't plug this in, the cord on it, it's hosed. Very fat plug. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to get on my respirator and take the knobs off and take the chassis out and take a look underneath. I want to see if there's any evidence of something having shorted out or self-immolated that could have caused that transformer to fry. With so many different sections in it, there's probably a lot going on there. It's interesting too, because the transformer also has a separate dedicated plug that it plugs into the chassis with. So I'm not sure why they did that. There's probably a reason for it. Who knows? I'll have to also see if it's actually set for 120 US voltages. US voltage. This is probably where you set it. And I have no idea if it has any markings on it or any indicator of what setting is what. I'm hoping maybe I can find a schematic if it gets confusing and it'll indicate where it goes. But anyway, I'll shut up. Let's take this out of here and see what's going on underneath the hood. Okay, this is what I tend to do. I just lift the chassis out gently. Don't scrape it. And then I wet the entire piece down. There's just some little staples holding in it, so I'm going to pry those out. And then I have a plastic bag handy. I'll fold it up, seal it up in the plastic bag. Most city ordinances in the U.S. require that you take this stuff to a hazardous waste facility. You don't want to, you know, throw it in the trash or anything like that, even though I know some people do it. You want to do it the right way. What I do is I have a bucket that is up in my crawl space that's filled with little plastic packets of asbestos, so someday I'll have to take it all over there, but you want to keep it out of the environment. So I'm going to pry these staples out, and then we'll pull it out and put it in a plastic bag. Okay, so here is the underside of the chassis, and quit poking me. My wife is trying to give away this cat tree that failed spectacularly with our cats because they're fat. Anyway, if I had known what I was going to get into, I may have not decided to work on this, because it's got the god-awful American pre-war rubber wiring, which means it crumbles if you look at it. The stuff has turned into rock-hard substance, and I'm going to have to replace a lot of it, because a lot of it's going to the electrolytic capacitor here, which needs to be replaced, definitely, all four. And some of these caps look kind of sick. When you have the ends shooting out like that, that usually means it's shorted. So this is going to be a job. It's too late for me to back out. Look at all these old school dog bone resistors. There's something else over here that's a little annoying. It looks like this wire that's coming off the tone and power switch, we're missing. This lead is going to nowhere. I think it might have gone to ground. It's got a little welded strip there. And the fact that it reaches down there perfectly makes me think that that could potentially be the case. But I could guess about it. I want to see if there's any voltage on it. Probably not, because this is probably just tone controls. That should probably have been going through a cap, because caps and resistors are what can affect your tonal range. So I'm not sure what's going on there. There are four electrolytic capacitors in this can. I'm not sure if you can see this. There's a 40, a 50, and then two 20 microfarad capacitors. It looks like someone might have been in here already. These two are, they look like they're replacements. They're kind of sloppily installed. The fact that they didn't wrap the lead around anything, they just stuck it there. And it's Mallory. Mallory was a higher cost component back then. General Electric probably would have used their own, because they also made tons of capacitors. In fact, that's the reason why today, parts of the Hudson River, if you dig down in the mud, it's considered a Superfund site, because all the PCBs that General Electric dumped in the river for decades. And 50 years later, its legacy is still there. So there's a lot of work to do just to confirm that this is actually going to possibly work. Again, I'm not sure what the story is with the power transformer. That's another thing I need to look at. I need to see if it's going to indicate to me what power setting it's on. I get a feeling it's probably 120, because it's 120 volt, typical American plug on it. But let's flip it over just to look. All right, it does indicate which voltages are which. It is set to 120. I get a feeling the transformer is probably okay. This is just shit that's oozed out over years and years of use. Again, I'm curious, why did they plug it in versus wire it in? That is really unusual. You know what? That'd make it a lot easier to actually test to see if it's okay. I can barely tell our color codes here. We have our red leads, our black leads. I'm assuming there should be another green. That's probably filament, 6-volt filament winding. Let's unplug it. Let's make sure that it's got some continuity here. Okay, I was able to measure the sets of windings, and they're all fine. So this transformer's all right. That's good. I'm glad I had that plug on there so I could test it easy. I'm going to bet this tube is bad. In fact, I already picked up a 6U5 spare at the museum. Anyway, I'm going to stop blabbering. It's the day after Thanksgiving. I'm still got a food coma from all the juicy food we had. but no better way than to waste an entire day than replacing lots and lots of crumbly rubber wiring. The other thing too is I need to fix the grill cloth on this guy. It looks like this whole panel comes out. And so I went to the museum and found some grill cloth fabric. Actually, I have two different options here. I have this stuff, which came off of a console. And I have this stuff here, which I think looks better, because this is kind of a blonde cabinet. The wood finish is not in great shape. I'm hoping I can bring it back a little bit. All right, so I've gotten a start here. I replaced all the electrolytics and the subsequent wiring that goes to them. Since this is chassis ground, I was able to relocate some of them, make it a little bit easier. Also installed a new cord. So I think I can actually test it, and I'm gonna see if it does anything. All right, showtime. Let's see if it works. Okay, we got filament. That doesn't sound good. That sounds like gassy tubes. I can't tell also what is the band switch situation. Crap. What is 1, 2? We want band number 1. So Jesus, it has a lot of bands. I think that's the band switch that I want. All right, let's plug it back in again. Hard to turn. Let me get one of the knobs. You know, I have no antenna hooked up. That would probably help. Let me hook one of those up. Okay, it's kind of an unhappy radio. It's picking up a little bit, but not much. So it's also got considerable hum. Now, I am wondering about that loose wire that was on the tone switch. I think it's time to pull up the schematic. Okay, so according to the schematic, this lead does go to chassis ground. But I tried that and it doesn't make a difference. Granted, we still have a lot of really crappy old capacitors in here that could be causing a problem. But I also have a suspicion that one of my tubes might have gone south. So I'm going to test those next before I get any further. Let me feel this guy has this. Good. Transformer's cool to touch. 25L6. I'm not sure if I have any of those tubes. I'm going to do the tube test, especially on the rectifier and the output tube. Okay, so I've got a sick tube here. I wouldn't trust it anyway. Let's see if it tests good. Oh dear. Wait a minute. 25L6. What am I supposed to push? 2 and 3 together? Oh, see, it's intermittent. That's bad. I sure hope I have a 25L6 over there somewhere. Okay, I had that tube in stock. So, let's try it again. see if we get any improvement. I don't know. B plus is good too. Alright, well, maybe I've got more than a few sick tubes in here. Alright, well, I'm still not really picking up anything. I'm picking up like a few stations, but it's very quiet. I think the audio is fine. I think the next best thing to do is continue recapping, because these caps are probably completely shot. Alright, well, it's clear that this capacitor has fused solid. You got a hole melted through there. That's definitely a problem. Yeah, so these guys are probably in shitty condition. I'm just going to replace the rest of them and then go back and see if we have any improvement. Alright, now I feel like an idiot. I've spent half the day trying to track down why this is not getting loud. And the reason is because these two clips on the back here need to be connected for the radio to work. And since I disconnected them, they weren't together. See? I feel like a moron. Why? Okay, let me just solder these two together. And then we'll do another test on it. All right, we're working good now. I probably maybe even need a little bit of a tune up here. Friends in the Bay Area telling the story of how you navigated these cones. In his sights, but he couldn't stop the pass from being completed. He did push him out of bounds, but the Bears got another set of downs. Exactly the flat I was talking about. You have to give up something on defense. If you're going to keep numbers in the box, then you're going to give up a flat. Generally, it's going to be into the boundary because you're going to have single coverage out there. The Bears saw it, took advantage of it. Great offensive call. Latu and Sturdivant are the wide receivers out to the left, right next door to each other. On the short side, there are two more receivers, and Plummer again in the shotgun formation with his running back to the left out. Quick pass, right sideline. And some room here out to the 45-yard line. Maybe the 46. Hit the nail on the head. My company is encouraging black entrepreneurs. For December. All right, I feel much better. Such a dumb problem. Now it's time to work on the cabinet instead of working on electronics, which is, I don't know. I'm done with electronics for the day. Okay, so I removed the front panel. Here it is, and I removed the old rotten grill cloth from it. This one is a light finish, so I'm gonna use Old English for light woods. You never know what the finish is actually gonna look like until you start cleaning it up. But let's try it out. And let's try to rub it in. Wow, already it looks like 10,000 times better. I'm gonna go over this whole thing with this stuff. Probably several times, because it seems like the finish is really dry. But it should look a lot better when we're done. Okay, well, I put that first application on there. While I'm waiting that for soak in, I'm gonna cut out the grill cloth for the front panel. What I'm doing is I'm waiting for my iron to warm up, and then we will go over it and try to get all the wrinkles out. Now, I'm not an ironing pro, This is definitely not my wheelhouse, but my wife taught me what you need to do is put down a towel and make sure you use steam. That seems to be gently removing the creases. Yeah, it's already looking a lot better. It's got that big crease in the middle there. Used a corner of the iron to get that out. There we go. I'm sure I'm doing this wrong. Like I said, I'm not an ironing person. Anyway, you get the idea. Okay, so I've cut up my cloth and I'm gonna glue it on top of the backboard here using good old-fashioned wig glue. I'm sure there's better glue to use, but that's what I've used for years. This is an interesting panel. Certainly not as straightforward as the ones I'm used to dealing with. All right, welcome to day two working on the GE. And since we got it working, it's time to finish some things up. Got a few more capacitors to replace, and I especially want to replace this wire that weaves its way through all this mess that is coming off the power transformer. It's a little too close for comfort to a lot of different things. That's most of the rubber wiring anyway that I've replaced, because inevitably most of it just crumbled in my hands. I did clean up the cabinet last night. It's got a lot of work to do on it. I think I'm going to apply some wax to it. And I did recover the front panel. This was an unusual one. Everything had to be sandwiched. Initially it had some, crinkling and going on in the fabric. And what you can do if you have wrinkling is you get a little water, get it moist, and then use a heat gun and it'll stretch it out. So let's finish up with the electronics and then we'll meander our way over to the cabinet. We're also going to add an audio input because this one already has one. It's right here, and the audio should, coming in from my audio device, should interrupt the radio signal temporarily when it's plugged in. This is a transformer set, so it's electrically isolated. We don't need to worry about high voltage on the chassis. Okay, I just made a horrific discovery. I should have known better. I knew it was an auto transformer. I didn't think about what that could possibly mean. That means that this set is actually not electrically isolated at all. It's a hot chassis. And however, I think I can remedy this by making sure that the set is not physically capable of being touched. I'm going to reinforce the back. These are isolated, and the knobs are held on with set screws. So there's not very really a way for anyone to touch this thing in the cabinet. So right now the back is outside with some wood reinforcements being glued to flatten it out and make it stronger, make it less, make it impossible to get your hands in unless you really try to remove it, basically. Got a few more wires to replace, a few more capacitors. My friend Rajesh is working on something. I think he's wiring a socket or something. What is that? Ah, okay. A curb tracer. I don't use that machine because I could shock the crap out of myself because I don't know what I'm doing with it. Okay, so I've added an audio input feature. First, we have a little rubber grommet so that cord won't chafe. And then we have it going through an isolation transformer since we need to make sure that the user is not going to get anything off the chassis. That's key. This already has rubber grommets, so the screws will be isolated. And the back is sitting outside. I've been reinforcing it to make it stiffer. And so it's time to work on the cabinet a little bit more, and then we'll put it all back together. All right, so now that I've electrically restored the set, I'm working on the cabinet. I'm using car wax, Carnauba paste wax, to bring back the original shine. It also removes a lot of the grime and the spider crap that's accumulated. I don't have my orderable buffeter today, and I'm paying for it. Okay, so I have reinforced the back. I know it doesn't look beautiful, but that's going to make it very difficult to remove. Well, no one's going to be able to get their hands through that. It's completely sealing off the back, and I got some oversized screws with some big washers. I did reassemble the front end. We've got the glass speaker installed. So it's starting to come along, looking pretty decent. And now it's time to put the chassis back in. I want to make sure my 6U5 tube is good. And then I will put it back together, call it a day. Yay, it's all back together now. Hey, well, you see, I now have a impregnable back. You can't get your hands in there. And we have a GFCI outlet also installed, so it's about as safe as can be expected, I think. And these knobs are really screwed on. You really can't tug them off. Alright everybody, thanks so much for watching, and until the next time some piece of junk comes across my workbench, I'll see you guys next time. Adios!